Hey, thank you for wanting to listen to the next chapter of Star Trek Voyager Season 8. If you didn't know, these chapters are just pieces from a larger episode. If you want to listen to the entirety of a full episode, check out the playlist in the show description. Otherwise, on with the story. Thank you for listening.
Let me wrap my head around this. If the holo emitter carries your entire program, the storage capacity is equal to a modern specced Starfleet vessel?
With plenty of space still available.
The EMH responded with a quick, self-satisfied nod.
In addition to the extra teraquads inside me, compared to the average hologram.
Another officer stood over his holo-emitted shoulder.
I bet.
A young engineer studied the doctor's arm and rested his face as close as he could to the device, without blurring his vision. A year earlier, Mr. Barclay had ferried the doctor in a briefcase to Jupiter Station, curing Dr. Zimmerman. Today, the EMH role-played as Voyager's publicist in front of Pathfinder's technicians. A crowd had gathered in the main lobby and asked questions. They pushed aside empty lounge seats as people jockeyed to meet Mr. Barclay's guest.
The attenuation of the holo-projecting lens must be incredibly refined to project your image in the manner it does.
Well, that's 29th century technology for you.
The doctor smiled, swinging his arm carrying the mobile emitter. A Tellarite pushed to the front.
What is the composition of the alloy?
The doctor pointed at the device as he answered.
I believe it's a blend of nilamite, duridium, and an alloy called polydeutonic.
Polydeutonic? Huh, that was theoretical until 5 seconds ago.
She scratched her beard, excited.
Sorry, and you said it is backwards compatible with current technology?
Clarified another technician, recording the conversation with his pad.
Yes, that's right. The device includes the compatibility protocols. We've never had a problem switching my program from the ship's holo emitters to the...
A junior lieutenant interrupted the light-generated man.
It doesn't matter anyway. We can't replicate the alloy or dare to reverse engineer it. It would be comparable to giving a phaser to a 17th century gunsmith.
Excuse me, Lieutenant.
I'm Lieutenant Hedor Pavax.
The Trill answered, as though complying with a questionnaire.
Well, Mr. Pavax, while that's astute, we have spare alloy. Strip it from the 29th century Borg drone we birthed.
Everyone in earshot paused, as though stuck in their own alcoves. The atmosphere in Pathfinder's lounge area shifted.
By accident, of course.
The doctor looked at everyone, noticing the change in atmosphere.
No need to worry. He's been dead for years.
Mr. Barclay watched his department let out deep breaths and place hands on hearts.
And you brought back another Borg. Why isn't it here?
Her name is Seven. She has personal affairs to attend to.
Seems like Voyager had fun in the Delta Quadrant.
Knuckles resting on the receptionist's counter, the doctor stated,
I guarantee it wasn't fun. Terrifying is the appropriate adjective.
Hedor Pavax frowned and considered how a hologram could comprehend terror. The junior lieutenant looked at Reginald for clarification.
Aren't we altering the timeline by talking about this?
Oh, Admirals Paris and Mitchell gave us authorization.
Heads nodded in agreement.
Anyway, how can we be certain that we weren't meant to invent this emitter?
Barclay's colleague smirked at his paradoxical joke. Voyager shared technical information with Pathfinder during the data streams, but excluded the mobile emitter, the schematics for the flyer, and its newest enhancements.
How long can the device maintain a holographic image before it needs recharging?
Oh, I rarely wear it at length. But on one away mission, I wore it for 3 years without requiring a recharge.
A 3-year away mission? How is that possible?
Inquired a Vulcan female.
Doctor, this is Ensign Lattle.
Pleasure. On Stardate 53502.3, I beamed down to a planet that, shall we say, didn't operate in normal space-time. My 3 years were a mere 18 minutes aboard Voyager.
Wow, this Mark One is so compliant.
Exclaimed a young human male wearing a uniform so crisp, it appeared as if he had graduated yesterday.
Well, with personal interactions, I've expanded my capabilities.
You're even more polite than the Mark II.
He responded with a, only perceivable by dogs. The Vulcan woman glanced at him.
I'm not happy about being reassigned tomorrow. I'd have loved to learn more about the emitter,
agonized the officer.
That's double unlucky, because you're not to discuss what you've seen here. Understood?
The disappointment evaporated as he replied.
Yes, sir!
If you still want to indulge yourself, however, I won't mind if you continue to probe our new friend.
Thank you, sir.
Commander Pete Harkins cut through the huddled group and approached the Doctor and Mr. Barclay. He reiterated the transfer orders from Admiral Paris.
You'll be pleased to hear that you're stuck here with me, Reg.
Thank you, sir.
We should be the ones doing the thanking. Our efforts have paid off because of you. By the way, Admiral Curry will arrive tomorrow to assume command. A presentation is required by 0900 hours. Are you up for it?
Barclay shared an affirmative nod.
Certainly, sir.
Pete handed Barclay a pad with the report created by Seven and Icheb.
This will help. Doctor, thank you for being here. We would appreciate the help since you're with us.
Happy to, sir.
Officers, engineers, and technicians dispersed from the lounge area as Commander Harkins tasked them with the department's reorganization. Pete's interruption gave the two friends a private moment.
Okay. Are you okay?
Break up this clique.
Well, let's just say I feel like I'm contributing.
The EMH smiled. Reginald squeezed the pad under his armpit and interlaced his fingers, gesturing.
Come now, you enjoy an audience.
I admit, I do think I have a lot to offer, especially beyond having better manners.
His brows twitched and his eyes narrowed.
Though I noticed nobody asked about me, only the emitter.
Oh, well, this bunch isn't experienced in holotech. I'm the expert on that. I understand, but you must acknowledge the device on your arm and a deceased 29th century Borg drone are captivating.
He leaned closer.
These people haven't even explored deep space.
The Doctor glanced at the officers at their stations.
I guess so.
Barclay patted his friend's shoulder.
Speaking of holotech, can I give you the tour? Try to guess which workstation I live at. It's Dr. Zimmerman approved.